Next item of business is topical questions. In order to get as many people in as possible, short and succinct questions and responses would be welcome. And I call Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the use of face-to-face GP appointments.
Cabinet Secretary Hamza Youssef.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I take this opportunity to thank our hard-working GPs for all that they have done before the pandemic, but crucially the good work that they've done during the pandemic. Public Health Scotland is publishing guidance on distancing and infection control measures in health settings. They'll be doing that to change the 2-metre rule to 1 metre. This means more potential space for patients in waiting rooms, where, of course, that is appropriate, while continuing to ensure everyone is kept safe. In light of this, joint NHS and Scottish Government guidance for general practices will be published later today. This is an important step in getting more in-person appointments in primary care. Today's guidance also makes clear that there's no longer a need to triage every patient, although GPs and clinicians should continue to screen patients for COVID before seeing them face-to-face. It contains resources for practices to help improve their communication with patients, as well as access arrangements.
Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We are facing a postcode lottery with patient experience in terms of trying to access their GP. While patients are permitted to have face-to-face appointments with practice nurses and other health professionals, GP appointments have been limited to phone calls, which in some cases have no specific time to call back. And with reports at the weekend of a new contract signed by NHS Scotland to expand these types of consultations, many patients are worried about access. We know that for many conditions, early diagnosis is crucial, yet so many patients are not able to get access to their GP. Does the Cabinet Secretary believe that Scottish patients have the right to see their GP face-to-face, and does today's guidance give us a date as to when they can expect that?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I do agree, of course, where that is clinically appropriate. But I'm disappointed somewhat that Ms Webber did not take the opportunity, as I did, to thank our GPs for the hard work that they've done over the pandemic, because it is not from a lack of hard work. Our GPs are working incredibly hard, as they have done over the last 18 months. What I would say to Ms Webber is, because of the appropriate and clinically advisable IPC controls in place, therefore that's why digital solutions such as the Near Me video consultation has been used. But yes, patient choice, I agree with Ms Webber, is patient choice is absolutely critical, and therefore the guidance published today will help to increase, I would suspect, and I would hope, more face-to-face appointments. But the Near Me consultation, video consultation, and digital platforms have been well used. We've seen in excess of 1 million appointments held using Near Me since the beginning of the pandemic. But I recognise, and our recovery plan lays us out in black and white, that face-to-face appointments can help us with some of the acute pressures we're facing in our hospitals. So I suspect, like everybody else in this chamber, I would like to see more face-to-face appointments, and hopefully this guidance that we'll be publishing will help in that respect.
Sue Webber.
Again, thank you, Presiding Officer. So no date then. As I mentioned earlier, accessing healthcare is a problem right now for so many patients. With many unable to access their normal healthcare routes, like going to their GPs, they are simply returning or turning to our A&E services. For the last 4 weeks in a row, we have seen the number of patients not being seen within 4 hours at our A&E hit shocking new highs. And with Scotland's largest health board, Greater Glasgow and Clyde, it's now telling people not to turn up unless it is life-threatening. What has been done to tackle these waiting times now, and as we move into the critical period of winter, what planning is underway now to ensure we do not see a future A&E winter crisis?
Cabinet Secretary.
So first of all, again, I would say to Ms Webber, clearly we are under pressure. Every single health service right across the world, I suspect, but certainly across the UK, is under pressure. She's absolutely right. A&E waiting times, target times are not being met. That is, of course, deeply regrettable. But I cannot magic away the effects of the pandemic. These are effects that are being felt right across the rest of the UK. And look, this is no consolation to anybody who's had to wait more than 4 hours, but our A&E continues to perform better than any other A&E across the entire UK. So we're taking immediate action. £12 million has gone to health boards to help with the immediate pressures. I hope to see some response and to the current crisis we're facing. But in terms of the autumn-winter pressure, I can give an absolute absolute assurance to Ms Weber, and if any member of this chamber wishes to have more detail about autumn winter planning, that planning started months ago. We are very concerned about winter because we suspect we'll see challenges around flu. We've already seen challenges around RSV, and of course autumn winter generally sees more trips, slips and falls too. So we are concerned, but we're already investing to make sure that our workforce continues to be not just at record high levels, but the best paid in the entire UK.
Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I would like to take this opportunity to thank our GPs and acknowledge the importance placed on high quality care and general practice, where GPs have time to nurture and maintain relationships of trust with patients. According to a recent BMA survey, one third of GPs are considering taking early retirement. And in relation to the government's remobilisation plan, Dr. Lewis Morrison, the chair of the BMA in Scotland, has said that the plan has worrying gaps, including the crucial omission of any plan to retain current NHS staff. The plan states there will be 800 new GPs by 2026 or 2028, depending which paragraph you read. So will the Cabinet Secretary clarify that target and outline what action will be taken in this current crisis to retain GPs and ensure sufficient capacity for people to see their doctor?
Cabinet Secretary.
So Mr O'Kane raises some really important points, many of them which I agree with. Retention is clearly going to be a key strategy and is a key strategy as part of our NHS recovery plan. In terms of the current workforce, the current GP workforce is at record levels, 5,134 GPs, and we remain on track to meet our target of 800 additional GPs by 2027.
Call Willie Rennie.
The Minister creates the impression that all these problems are new, but the problems within primary care were deep-seated well before the pandemic started, so a bit of recognition of the long-term problems wouldn't go amiss. I am concerned about the continued physical distancing of 1 metre. It's welcome that it's moved from 2 to 1, but it restricts the options for GPs to see some patients in person, even though that might be the best thing for them. Would you look again at the physical distancing rules in primary care and justify why he thinks it's appropriate to continue? Because it's not all about COVID anymore. There are other issues. I'm as cautious as any minister in the government about COVID, but I am deeply worried about the long-term and deep-seated problems that continue to exist within the NHS.
Cabinet Secretary.
So many of the actions that we have taken were pre-pandemic in terms of the increase in level of GPs, the record staffing level that we have invested in and funded. So we have taken action pre-pandemic, but equally I would say to the member, I know he knows this, of course, but it's worth reiterating. The pandemic has been the biggest shock our NHS has ever suffered. It is going to take investment, but also time. And that is why our NHS recovery plan is, of course, ambitious, but also realistic in its timeframes. Yes, I will, in terms of his ask, I will look again at the physical distancing. But what I would say to Willie Rennie, and I know he understands this, is that we, of course, take advice from public health experts and clinicians. Yes, we challenge them robustly, but ultimately, of course, it is important we take that clinical advice, but also take soundings from patients, absolutely, but also stakeholders like the BMA and the Royal College of GPs too. But he has asked me to look at that again. I promise him I will do that.
Julian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Clearly, restoring more face-to-face GP consultations as quickly and safely as possible is absolutely vital. But there are many people who have welcomed the opportunity to use e-health and telehealth solutions like Near Me to contact their GP. Can the Health Secretary confirm that these new avenues will be maintained after the pandemic for those who choose to use them?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, absolutely. I think it's a really important point by Gillian Martin. A number of surveys that have been carried out have shown that a significant majority, in fact, in some of these surveys, of people prefer to have a telephone appointment or indeed a video consultation. I myself, a couple of weeks ago, I mentioned this at committee this morning, I was able to phone my GP to get, when I had an eczema flare-up, to get the ointment that I needed. And it was all done without having to disrupt my work. I could do it in between calls and made life easier for me. That is not the case for everybody. Clearly, many people, in particular demographics, would like a face-to-face appointment. So having that mix of both Near Me, having the video consultations, telephone consultations, as well as face-to-face appointment, having that hybrid mix of options is certainly something that I'm keen to maintain.
Question number two, Neil Bibby.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the ongoing industrial disputes with ScotRail.
Minister Graham Day.
President Officer, firstly, I want to reiterate this government's recognition and appreciation of the contribution that all our rail workers made during the pandemic to keep rail services operating. There's actually only one dispute currently impacting ScotRail services on a Sunday. As part of agreed working conditions, all rail staff who work on a Sunday receive an enhanced payment. The current dispute concerns enhanced payments for working rest days. That arrangement made between the RMT and ScotRail provided an additional time-limited enhancement for ticket examiners and conductors, largely in acknowledgement of the extra work existing staff were undertaking while ScotRail recruited and trained additional staff to minimise the requirement to work rest days. Now that there are 140 additional ticket examiners and conductors, the issue of excessive rest day working has been resolved. I understand why the unions and workers might want to make that additional allowance permanent, but it simply isn't sustainable in the long term. I know that one group of RMT members has now voted in support of extending the current industrial action, but I would encourage settlement of this dispute. Any cancellations as a result of industrial action not only have the potential to undermine the recovery of our rail services, but also to impact on vital revenue streams from ticket sales.
Neil Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Industrial relations on Scotland's railways are at an all-time low. That is a damning indictment of a Berlioz treatment of key workers who kept Scotland moving, and a damning indictment of this government too. They are leading Scotland into COP26 with growing unrest on the railways and the prospect of strikes bringing Glasgow to a halt. It is a national humiliation and a failure of leadership from this government. The Minister must get a grip, and get a grip now. Why has he not intervened to ensure a satisfactory resolution to 6 months of RMT action and overtime bans? Will he intervene to ensure ScotRail dispute with engineers, who have voted overwhelming for strike action last week, is resolved? And why does the Transport Minister believe industrial relations nosedived in these final months of the Abellio contract on his watch?
Minister.
Officer, in regard to negotiations, these are a matter between the transport operator and the trade unions. However, I have had a number of discussions both with Abellio and the trade unions and encouraged every effort to be made, every constructive effort to be made to try and resolve this situation. But we cannot continue with a situation with the funding that is going into rail at the moment. To make the Chamber aware, pre-pandemic, Scotland was spending circa £1.1 billion a year on its railway, and that covers all aspects, including investment. Currently, because of the investment, the money we've had to put in because of the pandemic, that's risen to around £1.5 billion, and that is simply not sustainable. But what we have done is encouraged the unions and management to come together in a constructive way to identify efficiencies from both sides which could be used to fund reasonable pay increases, and I reiterate that point today.
Neil Bibby.
Thank the Minister for that answer. It is a matter for the operating and trade unions, but it is also a matter for the Transport Minister and the Scottish Government. The Scottish Government and taxpayers are paying ScotRail for a 7-day-a-week service and getting 6 days at the moment because ScotRail doesn't have the workforce to cope with an overtime ban. Workers' terms and conditions are under attack. Jobs and services are being cut. ScotRail won't rule out compulsory redundancies. Key workers aren't getting the fair deal they deserve, and neither are passengers who can't even get replacement bus services on a Sunday. Abellio is making a mockery of this government's commitment to fair work, as are 5 SNP MSPs who have done nothing to resolve this dispute and who shamefully blame disruption on Scottish workers exercising their rights instead of ScotRail's intransigence. So can I ask the Minister, whose side is the government on? The workers defending their jobs and conditions and services for passengers, or unreasonable bosses who, in the advent of COP26, are wrecking our railways?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, this government is on the side of delivering a sustainable rail service for the future and protecting the jobs of the employees. But this is a time for everyone to act responsibly, a time for recognising the challenges we face on the rail and finding a way to build back from the pandemic in a manner which delivers a more sustainable and efficient service which is ready to meet future demand. And everyone includes Labour. No politician can expect to be regarded as credible if they are arguing, as Labour appear to be and have been over the last week, that at a time when public finances all around face extremely significant challenges, we continue to subsidise the pre-pandemic pattern of rail service, regardless of affordability and usage, and we meet the cost of pay claims without seeking to achieve that by delivering efficiencies. Presiding Officer, We all aspire to have an efficient and sustainable rail service, and we all have a responsibility to help the delivery of that.
Graham Simpson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Cuts to services, a dispute which has now passed 130 days, 90% of Sunday services cancelled, engineers now threatening strike action, and the looming threat of this continuing when world leaders visit rat-infested SNP-run Glasgow in November. All this happening on the Transport Minister's watch. When's he going to take control and get this sorted?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, a typically pejorative contribution from Mr Simpson. Let me share with the Chamber that behind all of the rhetoric that is going on around this dispute, and I agree that the unacceptable nature of no Sunday service for passengers, but behind the rhetoric, there are moves behind the scenes to try and resolve some of these disputes. There is a meeting taking place today with one trade union in the Belwell, and I know there's another one planned for later in this week. So every effort is being made within the constraints I've highlighted to bring this to a conclusion.
Mark Ruskell.
It does appear that we're now in a perfect storm with COP26, disputes, timetable changes that are rocking the confidence of workers and the travelling public. But next year, ScotRail will pass into public sector ownership. So can I ask the Minister what kind of best practice from the public sector in terms of industrial relations, fair work, patient negotiation and consultation can be brought to the new franchise?
Minister.
Mark Ruskell makes a very fair and reasonable point, and that is where we aspire to get to. We need to, well, I hear groans from the Conservative benches, but it is the most constructive contribution we've heard this afternoon. The model that we want to deliver is one that protects the jobs of workers, delivers fair wages and has negotiating protocols in place which allow them the right way to seek a reasonable pay increase for their members. All this can be achieved with a reasonable and proportionate approach from all sides, and that's what we look to deliver going forward.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions.